Okay, so we're going to start with section 1.1, functions from a calculus perspective. The first thing we're going to talk about are the real numbers. We've talked about those probably back as early as eighth grade in middle school. You've classified types of numbers, so that's what we're going to start out by doing. We're going to go and look at all of the types of real numbers that we have. We're going to start with the smallest set right here on the inner circle. We have our natural numbers. When you were a toddler, your parents probably started to teach you how to count, and they would start with one, and that would be our first natural number. The natural numbers are all of the positive integers going off to infinity. One step bigger than that, we have the whole numbers, denoted with a W. The whole numbers are one number larger than the set of natural numbers. They include zero. So the smallest whole number is zero, then one, two, so on and so forth. After that, we have the integers. Those are usually denoted with a Z. And the integers, we could think of the integers as all of the tick marks on a number line. So from negative infinity all the way up, starting maybe, we'll write down negative 2, negative 1, 0, 1, 1, 2, if I could write, so on and so forth, all the way up to infinity. And then in this whole left side, we have our rational numbers. So we have our rationals. So our rational numbers are all of the numbers that are included in the naturals, the whole numbers, the integers. Those are all rational numbers. But even further, we have decimals that truncate, for example, 0.75, decimal that might repeat, maybe 0.3 repeating. We would also have any fraction that can be written as an integer over another integer, so maybe 5/7, things like that. The other side on the right, the other subset, would be our irrational numbers. So irrational numbers are any decimals that don't repeat. One of the most popular irrational numbers would be pi, 3.14, on and on and on and on, no repetition, no end. Or other rational numbers would be any square roots that are not perfect squares. The square root of 2 is an irrational number. So those are all of our real numbers. We know, obviously, that we have imaginary numbers. You've studied those. But for all intents and purposes, today we're going to focus on the reals. So over here in this other chart, we're going to classify them one more time. Our irrationals, a capital I, maybe with a double stem, those are our irrationals. A couple examples there. Again, pi, maybe the square root of 13. Okay, any decimal that doesn't repeat or doesn't end. Then we have our rationals with a double stem, R, a lot of times denoting that. And those are any kind of fraction or decimal that does not repeat or that truncates, or a decimal that may repeat, maybe 0.6 repeating. Okay. Then we have our integers, getting smaller as we go in sets. Integers, for example, negative 1 is an integer, 0 is an integer, 5 is an integer, just some examples there. Whole numbers, all of our positive integers and 0. So these are our whole integers. We have 0, 1, 10, all the way up to infinity. And then our naturals. And again, the smallest natural number would be 1, 4, 12, just a few examples there. Okay, so those are our sets of real numbers. We want to make sure that we understand what those are as we move forward and talk about domains and ranges and sets of numbers and intervals. Okay, next we're going to talk about interval notation. Interval notation is something you studied a good bit in Algebra 2. So we're going to review that. Interval notation uses inequalities to describe subsets of real numbers. Okay, so interval notation is going to use some notation that will describe subsets of real numbers. When we want to include those endpoints, included endpoints, if you remember, are going to be indicated by brackets. Okay, when we want to say that one endpoint is a part of the set, we want to make sure that we have a bracket there. Excluded endpoints, when we don't want to include that endpoint, we indicate using parentheses. Okay, so if an interval is unbounded, that means it's going to go on forever in one direction or the other. It's going to get really, really big or really, really small. To represent unboundedness of an interval, we're going to use positive and negative infinity, and those will always use parentheses. Infinity is more of a concept, not an actual number. Okay, so let's look at some examples. We want to write each set of these numbers using interval notation, so brackets or parentheses on either endpoint. From negative 8 up to 16, so what this is saying is x is going to be greater than negative 8 and at the same time less than 16. One thing that may help you is to draw these inequalities on a number line. Something that you practiced in Algebra 1 and Algebra 2, this might help as well to draw these out. So negative 8 and 16, they cannot be negative 8, cannot be 16, but the numbers we're looking at are right in between, everything in between negative 8 and 16. So interval notation would say from negative 8 being the smallest on the interval but not including negative 8 up to 16. And again, not including 16. So this is not an ordered pair. This represents an interval, all of the numbers in between those values. Okay? Next, we're going to look at letter B. X is less than or equal to 11. So if we were to graph this on a number line, and again, not necessary, but might be helpful, there's 11. X is less than or equal to 11. So we're going to shade in that circle. And then all of those values they're talking about would be to the left of 11, everything that is smaller. To do that in interval notation, we always have to go least to greatest. Have to make sure that our interval goes from least to greatest, whether or not we have brackets or parentheses on the ends. So if we look at this interval, that goes all the way down to negative infinity. Again, making sure you use a parentheses. Up to and including 11 with a bracket. So that would represent that set in interval notation. When we look at example C, this says that everything less than or equal to 16 is in the number set that we're looking for, or all of the numbers that are greater than 5. So if we look at all of the numbers that are less than or equal to negative 16, that includes negative 16, and to the left. If we look at the other set, we're at 5, but we don't include 5, everything that is greater than 5. Okay, so we actually have two intervals. To define the first one on the left, that would go from negative infinity up to and including negative 16, so we want to make sure we use a bracket. Or our other interval starts at 5, so we want to use a parentheses, and it goes all the way up to infinity, again with parentheses. So there's an interval that defines that. The last one, letter D, says all x's such that it does not equal 11. X cannot equal 11. So if we were to graph that, it is an open circle at 11, not including 11, okay, and then it's everything to the left and everything to the right. So those two intervals, the one on the left would be negative infinity up to 11 with parentheses, so it's not included, and then pick right up again at 11 and go all the way to infinity with parentheses. And again, these are intervals that define a region on those number lines or a certain portion of the x-axis. Okay. Now we're going to move on to functions. A while back you learned, oh goodness, probably in Algebra 1, that a relation is a rule that relates two quantities. Everything is a relation. Relating any two quantities, you have some kind of relation. All of the inputs were called your domain values. and you referred to those most of the time as your x values. Variables can change, but usually we call those our x values. The set of all outputs, you probably know now, is your range. And those would be all of your y values. There are four different ways that you can represent a relation. We can represent a relation graphically by looking at a graph. Okay. We can represent a relation algebraically, being given an equation. For example, maybe y equals 2x plus 3. There's an algebraic representation. We can also represent a relation verbally. These are your popular word problems. So we might say, just to keep it generic, output is 3 times the input. So just a way to write a relationship with words. And last but not least, numerically. So by numerically organizing the data, we can represent a relation. We can do that with ordered pairs. We can also do that with tables and mappings. Okay, so there's four ways to represent relationships, graphically, verbally, algebraically, and numerically. So then, after you learned what a relation was, you did a subset. A smaller type of relation, more specifically, is called a function. It's a special type of relation where every element in the domain, each element in the domain, exactly one element in the range, okay? So another way to think about this, I like to think about it like this. The X's don't share. Now you're not gonna see that in a math textbook, but that's always how I've thought about it. The X's do not share. For example, if I have the function, or if I have the relation, let's say I have 1, 3, I have 4, 7, and I have 1, -5. This would not be a function because 1 goes to 3 and 1 goes to -5. You have x's sharing. So this is not a function because of the 1, 3 and the 1, 5. 1, -5, excuse me. Okay? So looking at those relations, we see that the x's don't share. If we were to look at a graph, so the next one, graphically, the way to determine if a relation is a function is check that each possible vertical line through the graph intersects at one point. This method, you probably remember this, is called the vertical line test. This says that we can draw a vertical line anywhere on the graph, and we're only going to touch that function or that graph one time. Okay, we also refer to it in short form, VLT is how I write it quite a bit. Okay, so let's put those tests into practice and look at these examples. We want to determine whether each relation represents y as a function of x. So the first one, A, this is a verbal representation of a relation. So let's see if it represents a function. It says the input value x is the height of a student in inches. So x is the height of a student, and the output y is the number of books that the student owns. So we have the height of a student in inches versus the output. And we want to think about this. Could the x's, could the student heights share, or could they repeat to different y values? And so while the concept is pretty easy, sometimes it takes a little bit to think about. So if we have a student that's maybe 5'6", they could have 4 books. Maybe we have another student that's also 5'6", and they have 6 books. So because we could have a student, or 2 students that are the same height with a different number of books or a different output, this is not something that could represent a function. This relation would not be a function. Okay, let's look at B. Now we have a numerical way of organizing this data in the form of a table. So as we look at this table, I have my X's and my Y's, and I can see that 1 in my domain goes to negative 1 and goes to positive 1. And I also see that 4 goes to negative 2 and positive 2. So I have not one, but I have two places that make this not a function. Okay, letter C. Now we have an algebraic representation. So from looking at this equation, we can actually, I think the easiest way to do this is take a look at what its graph would be. So x squared minus 3, that's actually, hopefully we know that this is a parabola shifted down 3 units. So we're going to drop that parent function down 3 units. So from the algebraic representation, we have a graph, and we can see that this would absolutely pass. Oh, that's not very good. Let's see. It would absolutely pass the vertical line test. I could draw a vertical line anywhere, and it would only touch it one time. So yes, this is a function. It passes the vertical line test. Okay. Now we want to look at letter D. Letter D is x equals 3y squared. Now you may not know really what this looks like. I'm going to show you, and then we're going to talk about how we can know what it is without understanding the graph possibly. So this is actually, you see a squared term, but it's with the y instead of the x. So this would be actually a parabola that is on its side. And if you know that that's what that graph would look like, you would then quickly know that, nope, this is not a function. It fails the vertical line test. So the answer here is no, it fails the VLT. Now, if you're not sure why that's a parabola on its side, you could also create a table of values, and you could see that whether or not you plug in a negative 1 or a positive 1, you're going to get 3 for both x values. So you would have the point 3 negative 1, and you would have the point 3 positive 1. So this would not be a function. You could quickly do a table of values there. Okay, so now that we know what a function is, we're going to talk about function notation. This is something they probably brought to you at the end of Algebra 1. So this again should be a little familiar. In function notation, the symbol f of x right here is read just that way, f of x. And the way we interpret that is that really the title of the function is f. So we would say that that is f, it is the function f at x. And x is going to be our domain value that we would plug into the function. Because f of x corresponds to the y value, okay, f of x is the same as the y value, we can say this, that y is equal, excuse me, to f of x. They are interchangeable. So whereas we used to in Algebra 1 see y equals negative 4x plus 2, now most of the time in Algebra 2 you saw it written like this, f of x equals negative 4x plus 2. Which is our function notation. So because now x can be any value, if it can be any value in the function's domain, independent of anything else, we call it the independent variable. Okay, so that is again our x value, our domain, our independent variable. It goes into the equation, our input. But a value in the range of f is then called the dependent variable. It depends on whatever you put in for x. Okay, so now we have independent and dependent, two more terms to represent our input and output. Let's put that into practice now. So example 3, if f of x is equal to x squared minus 2x minus 8, we want to find each function value. So let's take the first one. I want f of 3. That means I'm going to replace x with 3 in this function. So f of 3 is going to give me 3 squared minus 2 times 3 minus 8. So then I have 9 minus 6 minus 8, 3 minus 8, and that's negative 5. Again, make sure you know your order of operations. That's going to be critical in pre-cal. So we have negative 5 for the value. That means that when you plug in x as 3, you get negative 5 as a result. All right, moving on to b. Negative 3d is going to be my input. So wherever I have an x value, negative 3d is going in. So f of negative 3d will be, make sure you put parentheses around this negative 3d. I'm going to square it, and then minus 2 times negative 3d minus 8. So now when I square negative 3d, make sure you square both pieces. That becomes 9d squared plus 6d minus 8. There are no like terms among those three pieces, those three terms. And so 9d squared plus 6d minus 8 is your final answer. That is simplified form. So I'm going to erase these because we have one more to do. And I'm going to get this out of the way a little bit here. Let me shrink this down and move it out of the way. Okay. So lastly, we're going to do f of 2a minus 1. So wherever I have an x, 2a minus 1 is going in. So here we go. Let's try this one. We're going to take 2a minus 1 and square it, minus 2 times 2a minus 1. And minus 8. So the first part here, you have to FOIL. Now, if you're not real comfortable with FOILing right now in your head, don't worry. Just go off to the side here somewhere. 2a minus 1, 2a minus 1. I would rather you be careful and not make mistakes as we kind of get back into the groove of things and get the rust off. So first gives me 4a squared, outer minus 2a, inner minus 2a, and last plus 1. So when I FOIL that, I'm going to come back up here. 4a squared minus 4a plus 1 when I square that. And now we're going to take and subtract 2 times 2a minus 1. So we're going to distribute a negative 2 minus 4a plus 2 and then minus 8. So when I put all my like terms together, I only have one squared term, so I have 4a squared. I use that. I have negative 4a minus 4 more a's, and that's minus 8a. Took care of those terms. And then I have 1 plus 2, which is 3, and 3 minus 8 is negative 5. So final answer, f of 2a minus 1 is 4a squared minus 8a minus 5. Okay, so using substitution there. Okay, on to the last page. Now we want to determine the domain of a function. Sometimes we can't just plug in anything we want for our x values. We have what we call restrictions. The two big restrictions we're going to talk about right now are values that would cause the denominator to equal a zero. Having zero in the denominator, or leaving a negative under an even root. Those are the two no-nos that we cannot have right now, okay? Now, talking about the negative under an even root, remember, we do have a way to write that solution, but it's not a real number. If I had the square root of negative 81, we can say that that's 9i, but that's imaginary, that's not real, and we're focusing on the reals right now. Okay, so we're not gonna allow negatives to be under the radical of an even root. And remember, if I take an odd root, if I took the cube root of negative 64, that is absolutely a real number. That is negative 4. Okay, so it's just under an even root that you would have to exclude a value, possibly. Okay, so let's look at these examples. State the domain of each function, and we want to make sure that we put it in interval notation with those parentheses and brackets. Okay, first of all, we have g of x equaling the square root of 4x minus 1. So we cannot have a negative under this square root. No negative. So let's figure out what we can have. I'm going to pull 4x minus 1 out from under there, and I'm going to say that, hey, you have to be greater than or equal to 0. Let's be clear. It is absolutely okay to have 0 under a radical as long as it's not in the denominator. The square root of 0 is 0. It always feels weird, but that is totally acceptable. So let's solve this inequality. We're going to add 1. 4x is greater than or equal to 1, divide by 4, and x is greater than or equal to 1/4. Okay, so if we want to write this in interval notation, here's what this looks like. I have 1/4. There it is. It can equal 1/4 or be greater than. So interval notation tells me with a bracket from 1/4 to infinity. There's my answer. So that would be the domain for g of x. Anything that is 1/4 or bigger. Okay, let's move on to b. The issue with b is the t squared minus 1. No 0 in the denominator. That is not allowed. So for this one, we're actually going to figure out what makes the denominator 0 and then use that as my restriction. So we're going to set t squared minus 1 equal to 0 and solve this little equation. So if I add 1 to both sides, t squared would equal 1. Take the square root. Now this is a quadratic. It needs to have two solutions. So t is positive and negative 1. So to look at what we're allowed for our domain, we can have anything we want except negative 1 and positive 1. That puts us into three intervals. So the domain in this case would be three separate intervals. The first one from negative 1 or negative infinity to negative 1 with the parentheses not included. Pick right up again with negative 1, go up to 1, and then from 1 to infinity. And there would be our domain, everything except for those two integers. Okay, and last but not least, we have C. So for letter C, we have a denominator, so we cannot have 0 down there, and we have an even root, so no negatives either. So we're going to pull this 2x minus 3 out, and we're going to say that it needs to strictly be greater than 0. It cannot even equal 0 because, again, it is in the denominator. So if we solve this inequality, we're going to add 3 to both sides. 2x is greater than 3, and so x is greater than 3/2. And so interval notation tells me that I cannot have 3/2, but I can go from 3/2 and up all the way to infinity. So from 3/2 to infinity, and again, these are your notes, so it's okay to kind of do these little hints if you want so you can study, from 3/2 up to infinity. Okay, you may not need to do those number lines, but for some people it just helps make it visual. Okay, so there we have a little bit on some of the restrictions that you may have started talking about in Algebra 2, but we're definitely going to do a lot more of that here in pre-cal. Okay, the last thing we're going to talk about today is a different kind of function, one that you haven't studied very much, I'm sure, a function that is defined using two or more for different intervals on the domain. This is called a piecewise function. So a piecewise function does just that. It comes in pieces. Before I read that application, I want to jump right down here. H of x is one piecewise function. It is one function, but it is in three pieces. The first piece implies that if we put in a number that is between 63 and 66, not including either of them, we are going to use 1.6x minus 41.6 to evaluate. If, on the other hand, we put in a number that is between 66 and 68 inclusive, we're going to use 3x minus 132 to evaluate. And If our no domain value is larger than 68, we're going to use 2x minus 66 to evaluate and get our h of x. So that's all there is to a piecewise function. So let's take a look at example 5 and see what they want us to do. The average maximum height of children in inches as a function of their parents' maximum height in inches can be modeled by the following piecewise function. So that's telling us what this function does. This h of x is the child, representing the child's height, that outcome. And this piece here on the other side represents, or our x value rather, sorry, our x value is what goes into the function, and that represents the parent's height. So we're using the parent's height to predict the height of the child. Find the average maximum heights of children whose parents have the given maximum heights. So in the examples, we are going to be given the parent heights. X is the independent variable representing the parent heights, and h of x is the dependent variable representing the child's height. So as we look at A, 67, we want h of 67. This means the parent is 67 inches tall, so what would we predict for the child? Well, 67 is the domain value, and 67 falls right in here between 66 and 68. So we are going to use 3x minus 132 to evaluate. So 3 times 67 minus 132. And off the top of my head, I believe that answer was 69 inches. I'm just looking at my key here because I don't have a calculator. Yes, 201 minus 132 leaves me with 69 inches for my answer. That would be the predicted child height. Letter B, we have 72 inches. Well, 72 inches is greater than 68, so we're actually going to use this third piece, 2x minus 66. So h of 72 would be 2 times 72 minus 66. That's 144 minus 66, which is 78 inches. Okay? And the last one, your parents' maximum height, that one's just for fun. If you know your parents' maximum height in inches, you can plug that in and figure out what your height should be in inches or what they would predict. Okay, so that takes us up through the end of 1-1. Hope you can go back through that and answer any questions. So I'm gonna sign off here. Let's see.